Thank you, especially Robin, for this just incredible introduction. I want the slides. There was one thing which was correct in the slides, actually, was the role of co-authors and also the role of role models. And I'm very glad to talk about Jean-Jacques Lafont because he showed us that what's impossible may actually be possible. And actually, it's a whole team in Toulouse. In other places around the European institution, you do as well, that actually can do things. It's hard, it's in Europe, it's a bit harder in the US, but Jean-Jacques Lafont definitely showed us that things are doable. So let me say a few things about this first slide. First, the Max Weber Conference, I'm very honored to be back to give once more time the Max Weber Conference lecture. It's very big honor for me. Another important thing is I'm in talk with my colleagues on this project. Some of the work is based on the work that Brandon mentioned with Colombia Labou. The third thing is that it's work in progress. So things have happened. There was a macro shock in October. Macro for me, not for the economy, but for me it was a macro shock which gave rise to things like this. And especially work in progress, and that's not Armin's fault, that's my fault. And so some of this still has to be worked on. I apologize for this, but I thought it would be a very good topic. Max Weber Fellows Program is actually a wonderful program. It's interdisciplinary, and that's also what we're trying to do in Toulouse in different ways with the Institute for Advanced Study. And this is a role model for us, it's very important that this. Wonderful Max Weber Fellows program. So I'm going to talk about moral behavior and what we, the broad agenda, which is both theory and empirics, because we have some experiments that we want to run on that. As usual, I'm going to develop some theory and tell you that there's evidence which is consistent with the theory. That doesn't mean that the theory is right, of course. It's consistent, it's encouraging. But you like to test the theory itself and not just use existing experiments to say that we are on the right track. The premise is that morality is malleable. It's something that is not given, it's something that changes a lot depending on the framing, depending on the environment and so on. It depends on the institution. It's going to, as you'll see, it's going to depend on the image concern. Self and social image concern. Emotions, I'm not going to talk emotions, but emotion that's of course very important. Personality traits and so on. So being a series, I'm going to start with a workhorse model. I'm going to jump right into it. And then argue that it's accounts for many realities. I understand some of you are not economists, but I think you'll get a chest from the model and the basic idea that's try to convey that, and if I don't convey, please interrupt me and say stop and ask questions or disagree. I'm going to answer that the role of self and social image in moral behavior, and then I say, here I always think about narratives. Organizational design is something which is not advanced enough. I will tell you what we are trying to do. There's much more to do than you know. I'm fascinated, Armin Clark and I are fascinated by how organizations shape morality. If you think about totalitarian regimes, for example, you can view those as being a couple of handful people with very bad morality. In practice, that's not the case. You have those leaders, of course, but there are lots of people like you and me who may or may not follow suit. That means that our morality is very malleable. And if we are put under the right circumstances, we may behave in ways which are pretty more. That's why we have to think about organizational design if we want to understand those things. And then we want to distinguish between narratives and imperatives and more deep development. We're not there yet, but I will try to mention what we are trying to do. The starting point is that, of course, there is a tension between moral behavior and negative self-image. It's actually very interesting to see that lots, you know, if you think about the Nazis, for example, lots of them actually, you know, they did incredibly bad things, and but lots of those them actually sort of themselves as being more in some way. And because they perceive, even they actually perceive the tension between immoral behavior and the self-image thing. Now, narratives are very useful when you're engaging in immoral behavior as an excuse. It's going to reduce the conflict between immoral behavior and self-image or social image. Basically, immoral behavior is going to be promoted by narratives and the events of those narratives. So they play a very important role in everyday interaction. So we try to attribute morality to external situations. We, you know, they've got time constraints and, you know, there's information we didn't have. But also in long-term societal developments. So I was mentioning the cruel persecution or stigmatization of ethnical and political minorities. So let me, for the outline, I'm going to jump right away, as I said, into the theory, give you some evidence which corroborates this, and so work for small, then I will talk about narrative and debunking. Shared responsibility, I will just sketch very briefly what we are trying to do because we haven't done it yet fully, and then I'll talk about imperatives and narratives. So the framework is based on the work I've done with Laurent Benabou in several papers. So basically, the basic framework is very simple. So think of an individual who can engage in a moral behavior or not. So A equals 1 would be the pro-social action. So I engage in a pro-social action or not, A equals 0. So I do it or I don't do it. And there is some cost to me. So, yeah, that's otherwise it would not be trade-off. I mean, if there was no cost to behave morally, I think most of us, almost everyone would behave morally, I think. But there's a cost cost sin. And we're going to introduce a self-control issue. So we may be tempted actually to behave immorally because of excessively tempted because we get an immediate benefit from behaving immorally. So the way we can formalize that, and there are many different ways of formalizing that. So you can just say that the recursive cost has been magnified. So if beta is less than 1, that means that the cost is magnified. Recursive, at the moment we take the action, recursive as higher than it is. So that's the hyperbolic modeling framework. There are many other ways to do that. For example, Fudenberg and Levin have a dual self model in which there is a cost of temptation and so on. For what we are going to do, this is perfectly fine. So, but of course, you know, there are still lots of debates about how it should be formalizing self control. The important thing is that the individual has values. V values can be V with some primitive role or 0, for example. The important thing is that there is randomness. You know, there are people who have higher moral values and some people who have lower moral values. And either the self doesn't know. So you know, self-signaling really means that you are trying to prove to yourself that you are a good person. Or maybe the audience is other people, so I want you to think I'm a good person. Okay, so that's called social signaling. So you want to think of me as being a good person. I want you to think that I'm a good person. Okay? But you know, going back to Adam Smith and to the philosophers, ancient philosophers, we also try to prove to ourselves we are good people, right? We want to think, looking at ourselves in the mirror, we want to think of ourselves as being good people, self-image often as well. So we start with some mean value, V-bar, which, let's say, is a probability in rho times V, probability that we are good people, okay? We are going to put a lot of the perceived magnitude of the externality. So the externality we normalize as being 1 or 0. 0 means there is no externality, 1 means there is a real bad externality on the concerned parties. So when we choose A equals 0, that means we exert a negative externality on the other party, which can be 0 or 1. Okay? And E actually is going to be the probability that there is actually an externality. I mean, that's one way of formalizing things. Basically, there is some probability that actually we're accepting an externality on the third party.
And negative is the non-negative.
I'm sorry?
is negative or positive externality?
Oh, the externality is going to be negative, actually, yes. It's going to be negative. So, I mean, it's just standard convention, you know, whether you. So, basically, say in a dictator game, I choose to take the others on for myself at the expense, at your expense, you know, you're going to get less, so that's a negative externality. So in a dictator game, for example, if I behave more socially, I lose a little bit of money, but I give some to Raman. So A equals 0 means that I don't give anything to Raman or something like that. So we're just, the next word is not very important, but we're going to pick parameters that are the low type, so type 0. Actually, never assume this to contribute, so always choose the A equals 0. And the question would be, does the I type type V contribute? Okay. You can make the reverse assumption. Questions? For those of you, so the important thing is that, and that's something we've worked a lot on with Ron Dinner, who is the introduction of a self or social reputation module. As I say, you can formalize either one. Social reputation is by far the easiest thing to formalize. As I said, I want to look good, you know, vis-a-vis you, so I want you to have a good image of me. At the same time, lots of experiments are in the lab, and there's no, you're not seeing what I'm doing, so I'm just trying to prove to myself I'm a good person. That's called self-signaling. So V hat would be the perception of the value given the action. So the action is going to determine the perception, and I'm going to care about it with intensity mu. So there's an intensity of image concerns for some people that is very high. For some it's low, but we're going to assume you as given, you know. Okay, we have some other work where we allow people to be endogenous with respect to image concern. Okay, so I told you that we assume that the low type will never contribute, but the I type may or may not contribute. So we assume that the I type contributes when certain that there is an externality, but not when it's certain that there is none. So, the benefit of contributing if E is equal to 1, so you know for sure there is an externality, would be V, if you have the I type. At the moment of you are contributing, there is a cost of contribution which is C, which is perceived magnified by one of the beta if you want, beta being less than 1. And then, what you are going to gain from contributing is that you are going to buy self-image or social image. Okay? So, instead of being the average V bar, so imagine that nobody contributes. If nobody contributes, everybody has, you know, the prior mean V bar. Remember, V bar is a prior mean. And that's the reputation that you're going to have by contributing A equals 0. But if you contribute, then you signal that you're actually the I type, and then you're going to buy some self or some sort of prestige by doing that. Okay? So we may do it because of image concerns. So that's positive. That means that you want to contribute when you are sure there is an externality. But if you are sure there is no externality, or if you have, you know, if you are low type, so you don't gain anything, you don't get any warm glow from contributing, then you don't contribute because you have a cost perceived as zero beta. You still get the reputation concern, but benefit, but that's it. Any question? So the consequence is a very straightforward model, and you already have a lot of consequences from that. So basically, if you just vary the probability of an externality, you are going to, you know that when you know for sure that there is an externality, the high type will contribute. When you know for sure that there is no externality, nobody contributes. And there will be an E star, which will be a very important role. So the E star is such that you are indifferent when you are high type between contributing and not contributing. So that's the equation here. V E star minus the perceived cost plus a gain in reputation, mu times V minus V bar is equal to 0. So that's when the high type is indifferent between contributing. So basically what it tells you is the following. I mean, you know, even if you have trouble with the mathematics, you know, the rest is quite intuitive. And this immoral behavior is encouraged by low image concern. I mean, that's pretty clear. If we have further any image concern, we are likely to behave immorally. Because, you know, that gives us an incentive to behave well. If we have a good initial reputation, okay, so if the bar is high, then we are going to behave more immorally. And I'll come back to that. That's followed by psychologists, more or less, I think. So if you start with other people thinking of you as being a moral person, or you yourself feeling as a moral person, then you are going to behave less immorally. If you have a low self-control, given that you are tempted to misbehave for short-term benefits, then you are going to behave immorally. If there is a high cost of moral behavior, then of course you will behave immorally. And when there is a low perceived social benefit from pro-social behavior, so you have a low anxiety, perceived anxiety, then you also can behave more immorally. So this is common sense. This model basically captures what you would think is common sense. So before I move on to the evidence, you may ask yourself, is the image concern beneficial or detrimental to the individual? And then you have to ask yourself, who is the individual? Is that the self who takes a decision, or is that an ex-ante self? Okay? So the exposed self, we have seen that A equals 1 if and only if the one blue game, which is V times E. That's for the eye, if you are the eye type, and then there's a probability E that you exert in X19. Minus 0 beta plus mu V minus V bar is positive. But there is an ex-ante self, which has two wedges, so the preferences of an ex-ante self differ in two ways. The first way is very standard, which is a self-control problem. So the ex-ante self anticipates that the exposed self who takes a decision is going to behave impulsively. So the impulse behavior, so actually that implies that actually the self-control problem acts against moral behavior, so you like to control the exposed self. But then there's the image concern as well, which is going to play an important role to explain some phenomena. So the image concern, think of the image as being a positional good. I mean, if you're a sociologist, you would call that positional good. It's an economist would call that a zero-sum game. You know, basically, the average image would be V-bar, regardless of what you do. Okay? So your average image would be just a prior, right? The law of iterated expectations. So, you know, so it's a zero-sum game. So you always buy self-image at the expense of yourself. Okay? And image concern is going to be to make us feel more morally, and actually that's something that is going to increase more behavior. So if you look at the ex-ante self assuming that condition on being a high type, but the ex-ante self doesn't know the type set, then you would like to choose A equals 1 when you have type V, if and only V times C minus C is positive. So so you see there are two wedges. You have C versus C over beta, that's a self-control problem. And then you have this image concern, which plays a role exposed, but doesn't play a role ex-ante because it's just a zero-sum game. Yeah, I'll come back to that later on. So there is evidence on self-control, for example. So when you vary beta, let me tell you a little bit about some experiments. And of course, Armin is more of an expert that I know. In the world of experiments. So, for example, there's this first experiment which shows that if you have a higher ability to use self-control strategies, so it's a self-reported measure. So, you know, about your strategies to exercise self-control, then you're also more willing to share the dictator game. So, the dictator game is, remember, is someone who beats. Whether to share with the other person or being selfish. Okay? So that seems to fit with the theory. Sometimes self-control is measured in the lab, just like in the second experiment or the third experiment. And what's the finding that true is that if you have a lifestyle control, then you are going to incorporate more in a sequential play your dilemmas problem. Sequential means you know, one place first and then the other. So the question is whether the first mover cooperates and then the second mover cooperates to the first mover as cooperating. Actually, it uses a strategy, it's not that. So, but again, if you have a higher beta, so if you have more side control, you be more pro-social, you cooperate more. And there are also some field experiments in the same thing. That's something which has been done with by my co-author, I mean, Mark and his co-authors. It's also based on reported self-control, so again, it's not derived from an experiment in the lab, but it's reported self-control, and it's a very big database, 80,000 people, and such actually 76 countries. And it tells you about self-control. So let me give you an example. When you are annoyed by someone, when someone is saying something you don't like, or you feel the person is an asshole, or is insulting you, your first impulse, and impulse is the right word, is to yell at the person, or even punch the person. That's your first reaction. If someone annoys you, you feel really getting back at the person. Now, you also know that getting back at the person is not always the right strategy. You regret it later on. Okay? So your impulse is to be mad at the person. You may actually be a self-defeating thing. And actually, people who are too impulsive, like that in organization, on the bottom, in personal relationship, of course. So that's a case where you have a trade-off between self-control and your reputation, your future, and social image, for example. Okay? And what they find is that actually they ask questions about the tendency to take revenge. Okay, do you want to take revenge? So for example, if you are treated unfairly, you want to take revenge on a person. And people who have more self-control actually they are less likely to take revenge. They will control themselves much more. Whereas people who have self-control crimes, they impulse people, of course, they will punch at the face of their colleague or something like that, right? Not here. Okay. No, but yelling at the other person or saying something nasty in response there, right? Moral licensing, we are psychologists who work on moral licensing. So moral licensing is pretty annoying. When you start with a better reputation, you're likely to be more annoying. So for example, Mona and Miller have experiments in which they let participants demonstrate their lack of prejudice, and then they ask them to let the world employ. So if you have demonstrated, for example, you are not a racist, then you are more likely to have a bias against blacks, for example. So those kind of experiments ask people, are you going to vote for Obama or McCain? And then they have a question about, who you should hire for the police department. And there was a white and black person. And the people who have voted Obama actually tend to actually more to actually disfavor blacks. Once they have shown they were not racist, then they can indulge and change their behavior. So it's actually interesting. Same thing, there are also experiments showing that if you write a self-relevant story in which you have positive traits, positive traits in terms of generosity and so on, then you don't donate less to a charity. Once you have acquired some reputation, that fits pretty well as well. That's pretty kind of obvious. I mean, I told you if you've perceived the externality as being larger, or the cost has been lower, then you're more likely to behave morally. And there are experiments like this, so I'm not going to discuss it, but I mean, this is kind of obvious. And along the same line, there is this work of Armin Falk and Chesh, which study was being pivotal affects moral behavior. So there are several experiments. By the way, they use what's called the moral byline. So the moral byline is the mouse byline, I'm sorry. the mouse byline is, I have a choice between being selfish and getting money, for example, but if I'm selfish, the mouse is going to be killed. I want to emphasize that Armin nor I are not mouse killers. Actually, what you do is that if you don't take the money, the mouse is going to be sick. Because in labs there are what's called surplus mice. And those surplus mice are always killed. Actually, not in a very pretty way, I said, but you know, they're always killed. So if you behave morally and you don't take the money, actually those mice will be rescued. So they are not mice killers, don't worry. But still, it's a mouse trap. So you can take the money, but then you know a mouse will be killed. So they have several experiments. One I will come back to later on, which is about trade and markets. But this one is a member committee. So if at least one takes the money, the mouse will be killed. So imagine there are 8 people in the group. If one of them takes the money, then the mouse will be killed. So that means that the externality somehow is lower when you misbehave. So if I take the money, you know, if I don't take the money, there's still a risk that Raman will actually take the money and the mouse will be killed anyway. So yeah, I'm going to say, sure, why don't I take the money myself, right? No, I took the wrong example, sorry. But the point is that with 8 people, there might be, it's likely that someone actually is going to take the money, and then why should I not take the money myself? So basically, it's a story where the C is the same, but the externality is smaller because you're less likely to be voted. Okay, it's less likely that your decision is going to affect this mouse. Okay, by the way, it's not a Kantian reasoning. You know, it's purely utilitarian. If you think about being pivotal, that means that you're thinking about probabilities. Okay, it's not necessarily I'll talk about Kantian behavior later on, but this is not Kantian at all. You know, if I say, you know, let me reverse it. If Raman thinks I'm going to kill the mouse, then he's really utilitarian in a sense, right? Because he's going to say, oh, I'm not going to be pivotal, I might as well take the money, right? Whereas if you were Kantian, no kidding, right? Regardless of whether you're pivotal or not. Okay. So let's not get into that, I thought it was the main thing. So let me talk a bit about narratives now. Okay? So the way we view narratives is as an instrument to reframe decisions in a self-serving fashion. So I want to behave normally. But I'm very worried about my image, self-image, and you know, social image. And therefore, I may construct narratives myself, or I may welcome your narratives. That is going to say, you know, it's not that bad in the end. So, externality is not that important. I may want to believe that actually there's not a big externality. Or maybe I'm not pivotal, I'm not the one who's causing the thing. That's for negative narratives, but negative narratives can be defined as someone who pushes you to behaving immorally, so choosing equals zero. And that's what the one I will talk about right now, and then I will talk about positive narratives, which are narratives which pushes you to equals one. So think about that as more models, or fairy tales, more anti-sexualizations, whatever. So the way you can formalize it, there are lots of different ways. We are not settled on exactly which one we want to use, but you know, one way of formalizing the narrative is just like, for those of you who are economists, like a signal. You know, you think of that as being a signal, say a signal, for example, about the externality, but it can be a signal about something else. So the externality I told you is 0 or 1. Okay, there is no externality or there is 1, or it's small externality or big externality, whatever. Was right, E and 1 minus E. Now think of the narrative as being a signal, for example, that will accrue for sure if there is no externality, but may also accrue if there's a positive externality or an externality, which quality Z. That's one way of formalizing, again, there are many other ways. But the basic point is it changes your beliefs. So So it tells you when you update your belief, it just tells you that actually the externality is not as bad as you thought originally. So you think of the externality as not being as bad. Okay? By the way, if I get a negative externality, a negative narrative, I want you, if I have a social image concern, I want you to also know about this negative narrative. Okay? Because you'll be assessing me. And because you'll be assessing me, I want you to know also this negative narrative. Okay? So let me give you examples of common narrative. The first very standard one is to downplay the externality. And that has been used by all the totalitarian regimes. So you dehumanize. You know, this third party is completely undeserving. They just get what they deserve. So we know that from the Nazi, but we know that from many other things. It could be a narrative about not being pure. So a discussion about this particular, Kitty changes only the experiment. There is not an experiment, unfortunately. But not dispute about that one, but this. Let's dispute about the bystander effect, which is, there's someone who's getting killed or murdered or whatever, and nobody intervenes. And the idea being, if I don't do it, why should I pay the cost? Somebody else will do it for me. Okay? And, nobody will end up doing it. By the way, again, it's a very consequentialist utilitarian reasoning if you think about it. Sometimes the negative narratives. How about the magnification of the cost C? So the typical one is, I was only following orders. I mean, this is a very difficult thing. I didn't want to do it, but I was following orders. It was so costly for me not to obey the orders. And that's very important. Okay? Another interesting narrative, by the way, is about omission versus commission. Something which is very striking is that omissions and commission, lying by omission and lying by commission, is viewed very differently. Even if so, they have the same consequences. Okay? So that's kind of strange. We all feel much better when we lie by omission than when we construct some story to lie by commission. We don't like to lie. Actually, often when we say we lie by commission. Omission is kind of milder or lie, even so it may have exactly the same consequences as commission. And in our view, the story is that it's much easier to find an excuse. I failed to say something which was relevant to the decision making of the other person. I forgot. I didn't draw the connection with what this other person was doing. I was in a rush, I had to rush. And so on. The ultimate one, which is very strange, is I didn't lie. Informally, yes, I mean, saying nothing is lying, right? But formally, I didn't lie. So different excuses that we have to lie by omission. And actually, that's what people, there are actually on that. Subjects often rate harmful omissions as less immoral than harmful commissions. And they think I didn't cause the outcome, that's another excuse. It's actually very interesting. Our mind is very willing to take bad excuses, and I'll come back to that. By the way, a narrative, you don't have to take it as face value, you may also try to debunk it. And one of the striking things about narrative is that actually you may end up not debunking very feeble, very weak narratives. So for example, you could spend some cost psi, maybe magnified by the immediacy prime, but to debunk the narrative, forget about the equation, but you could try to understand whether the narrative is correct or not. Okay, sometimes you can, but sometimes you can't actually try to think about it. And at some cost, you can try to see through the narrative. Now, the implication of that is that people with high IQ will have an easier time to debunk narratives if they are wrong. know, they look right, but they may be wrong. And in that case, we see some others. In that case, you can try to debug them. And the implication is that people with high IQ are more pro-social when confronted with fully negative narratives. So they will find out more quickly that actually the narrative is wrong. Okay? By the way, we don't have evidence on that. The prediction is that it's a reverse for positive narratives, actually. They also can debug those more easily. But the literature has looked more at negative narratives. So actually, there is some evidence on that. Also, it's not really a test of the theory. There's a lot of evidence on the correlation between morality and IQ. Okay. Now, we don't know why. That's why I'm saying it's encouraging, but it's not a test. We don't know why, actually. So it may be the case that people have self-constructive narratives, so they face a situation, they find a good reason not to do it, and then they don't debug that. Except if they are very bright, they cannot avoid debugging the narrative they have to write. Okay. So think about the narrative, the mass pilot, for example, narratives like, is the experimenter not me who is killing the mouse? Of course, if you choose to behave immorally, you're not killing the mouse yourself, but it's you know, technically the experimenter, actually it's not even the experimenter, it's somebody else in practice. But, you know, it's an easy to debug narrative. But, you know. So, in the mouse, surplus mouse killing stuff, and you have a banner choice to either kill a surplus mouse for 10 euros or not receiving the money, but then, and then you see the mouse. Okay? And then you see the correlation. If you have a higher IQ, you're going to be able to kill fewer mice. There is also, I mean, as some other evidence, basically, it's also self-reported by skill. So basically, think of that as a measure of IQ, one measure of IQ. And it increases altruism. Okay? Also, that's some behavior. Thing like that. Actually, this is the most interesting one in that respect, because it talks about markets, and of course, it has these very interesting markets. Again, we go back to mouse killing paradigm, and he looks at double auction markets, and let's take the simplest one, it's a bilateral trade. So bilateral trade is you and I can trade. If we both trade, if we agree to trade something, we both get a surplus each, so we both get money from trading. But then the mouse is killed. Or we can refrain from trading, and in that case, the mouse is saved. Okay. Now it's different from the committee example. It's actually the reverse of the committee example I gave you earlier, which is that. To get the more behavior, it takes only one to get the more behavior. So if you refuse to trade with me, the more outcome will prevail, the mouse won't be killed. Okay? So in a trading relationship, we both have a bit of right. So actually, it's going to be the case that you know, if you don't want to trade with me, then the outcome will be the more one. Which was different than the committee example, because in the committee example, if I give you more, then the outcome will be more. And what they find is that you compare that with a dictator game, and they find that market effects are so the story is a narrative, which is a wrong narrative, but it's very interesting. It's a narrative of shared responsibility. So imagine. Basically, we are two. We are two to decide to have the immoral behavior. Again, if you don't want to trade, the more outcome will prevail. Okay. So let's assume we trade in the end. Well, we have the impression that actually there's shared responsibility. Many people have this impression that it's shared responsibility. Even so, if you think about it, any of us would have said, no, we don't trade. We both have a veto right. But it's a kind of excuse, diffusion of responsibilities like an excuse. Oh, we were two, right? We were two to do it. So, you know, in a community, not, you know, if you need decision about unanimity, then it's going to be a good excuse actually to be able to be more. But interestingly, if you look at this diagram, people with a very high IQ actually behave more morally because they are more able to debunk this crazy narrative that we all have. Okay? So if we are part of the group, we feel less responsible. But given the technology, we are just as responsible, right? We are just as responsible. And you know, brighter people that debunk the narrative more easily somehow. So again, it's not directive in another theory, but it's kind of encouraging for the theory, it's kind of consistent with the theory.
What is fluid intelligence?
Oh, I'm sorry, fluid intelligence, there are two kinds of intelligence. But fluid intelligence is basically about solving novel problems. So, whereas crystallized intelligence is basically the ability to harness your knowledge and previous experience to apply it to a problem. So, it's a different kind of intelligence. Creativity is more linked with fluid intelligence, where you face a completely novel problem and you deal with it. It doesn't work for crystallized intelligence. So. There's interesting things to look at. Thank you for asking. Okay, so let me say a few things about moral rigor rule. So moral rigor rule is our situations in which the framing leads to a reduction in moral behavior. And there have been very, very interesting experiments lately on that. And that's possible, several possible explanations. One is you want to avoid signaling. Okay, the start story for that is there is a beggar on the sidewalk. You are going to walk past the beggar. You know that if you walk past the beggar, you feel that you have to give to the beggar. Either to signal to yourself you're a good person, or because you want to signal the, you know, your friends that actually you're a good person. So what you do is you actually don't really want to give. So actually you change the sidewalk. Okay? That way you won't have to signal. There are also experiments, economists have run experiments in which you give, someone is going to ask you for money, is going to come to your home to ask you for money at noon tomorrow. And you know, you want to be there. You know, most people actually make sure that they are not going to be there at noon. Not going to be faced with the decision of having to be. It may also be that it's an undebunked narrative. Okay? And I'll give you an example of the two. So, one of the famous papers in the literature is the Dina Weber and Quant paper, where they start from big data game. So, the startup big data game is that you choose between a selfish option, which is A, and a generous option, B. So a selfish option, you take 6 for yourself and you give 1 to the other. You don't know who the other is. It's someone in the room, for example, that you don't know who this person is. It's anonymous. And if you choose the moral solution or the generous solution, you take 5, you lose 1, but then you give 5 euros to the other. Okay? Look at the numbers. Yeah, maybe 75% of, or 2/3 of the people would choose a chance option. Okay, that's the start of the data game. People are willing to lose a little bit of material payoff to buy self-image. Okay, and they also have some intrinsic generosity, but self-image is important. Now, what data Weber did was to actually enlarge this paradigm. And say, now imagine that two states of nature, which are equally likely. There is a state of nature, which is just like before, I call it the dilemma state. So there, if you choose A, it's a selfish option, and B is a generous option. But there is a no-brainer state, which shows was quite one off, in which AAEs is always better from both point of view. So you get more for yourself and you get more for the other person. So each get 5 on the ray and on the you get 1. Okay. So you ask, do you want to know which state of nature prevails? You don't have to. You'll have to choose between A and B anywhere. And you know, start a decision maker, someone who is generous, truly generous, who has chosen B in the previous experiment, who would have chosen B in the other experiment, should say, I want to know, because in the dilemma state I would choose a generous option, and B, and in the no-brainer state I should choose A, whether it's a no-brainer. And behold, people say, I don't want to know. I just don't want to know. And when do they choose? They choose B, of course. Okay? They choose A, I'm sorry. They choose A, of course. And given that you don't know, you might as well choose A, right? But the point is that they are extremely selfish. The same people who have been generous otherwise are very selfish because they end up choosing the selfish option. And yes, they have this very bad excuse. Maybe I didn't know the other person. But that requires some debunking, right? It's an excuse, it's a narrative. I didn't know the other person. I may not have heard the other person, I didn't know. But of course, the very choice of not knowing is actually the more behavior. Okay? And now lots of other examples. There's a wonderful experiment on mitigation where, again, you have to choose between being selfish and being generous at the dinner game. But you can delegate a decision to an agent who is going to decide between A and B for you. And lo and behold, people understand the game quite well. So the agents, at least a number of agents, you can choose your agent, so there are several periods. And you can choose your agent as a decision maker, so the agent, you can delegate the decision to an agent. And at least some agents understand the game very well, they develop a reputation for being very friendly to the principal and basically do what they don't want to do themselves, do the dirty job. And it's a wonderful experiment as well, which is, so the dictator, and the dictator then delegates to the agent. So dictator, when he's just by himself and there is no possibility of delegation, actually is going to be kind of generous, at least, a bit generous. But he doesn't really want to do that, so what he does is actually to delegate to someone who's going to do the dirty job for him. Again, that's actually, this is a bad excuse again, but you know, people don't want this. You know, you don't want to fire workers. So what you do is that you ask someone to write a report and do it for you. Or something like that, you know, that's the idea for the thing. Okay. Well, let me skip that because I realize I'm a bit late, but there's this issue about shared control and subjectivity of responsibility that we're still working on. And of course, that touches on the... I would like to give you a few minutes for questions, but I really want to talk about imperatives, so that's okay. So let me just tell you what we do in the imperative stuff. So far, there are narratives, but no imperatives. So, think of a narrative, an imperative, as being a recommendation for an action as opposed to a signal. So for an economist, it's basically a Crawford Sobol thing where you basically recommend something, choose A equals 1. Now, I'm in the case of a principal who wants to induce the agent to behave more, for example. So it's soft information as opposed to a narrative, which is a story which has been come out. You don't try to explain, and the difference is that with narrative you're trying to explain why you should be doing this or that, equals 1 or equals 0. In imperative you said, you should choose A equals 1 or A equals 0, okay? And if you think about the benefit of imperatives and the benefit of narratives, so the benefit of imperative that it's just you have lower communication costs, you don't have to explain. I'm not going to formulate that. You know, is there monitoring? Of course, but it's easier to observe whether a person does it or not, as opposed to whether a person does it in a contingent way. And then the rest are formalized. An imperative is less fragile to interpretations of the deal of the debugging threats. And also it may allow to put states in which the agent will be reluctant to choose equals one, with other states where it will be very hard to choose equals one. So it's going to expand the range of behavior, of more behavior. But it has costs as well. You know, one is very well known, it's not flexible. When you say you should not lie, of course we know that some lies are very good, right? So, you know, you should not murder. You know, we think, no, of course there are some murders which are actually efficient, and tolerant in Emma, for example. You know, I'm completely amazed when I see the response of people to the tolerant in Emma. You know, are you willing to kill one person to save 10 people? I mean, I would say it's a no-brainer, but nobody would say, I'm willing to kill that one person. Okay, that's the tolerant in Emma. And that means, you know, we're being trained for good reason to basically say we are not going to kill. But, you know, killing, if it saved many other lives, actually may be efficient. We are not going to torture, we are not going to lie, we are not going to... Those are pretty good things, of course. We do think they are pretty good things, but in some cases they can be dysfunctional. Even if they are not, even if they are not agency costs. There are other reasons for why you don't want to allow them, which are through with agency. You may not trust the people to have the right taste, but even then, even for yourself, we will not, you know, get dysfunctional. Okay? It's more rigid, and it's also less effective if you have lack of concrete. So, you know, one of the results we're going to obtain is that we accept imperative from principle with high moral standard. Your parents, religious, wise people, whatever. Whereas narratives can be spread by almost everyone. So let me just tell you how you reformalize that. So imagine that the principle as utilities is going to be contingent on the world type, because only the world type has a choice, frequently world types are going to be more anywhere in this framework. The principle as utility A, 0, 1, UP of E, that is the principle and function of E, so we can give you examples. The principle might be the parent, or society, or the teacher, or whatever. And the agent might be individual. And the agent you did is A times U A of E. Again, for time B. Okay? And those are affine functions because E is a probability. And let's assume that the principle is actually more here to a social action. Now again, if you think about the Nazi example, it's a reverse. I'm just taking an example. You like people to be more moral. Okay, so how do you like people to appear more money, it's going to make a speech in that direction, or it's going to make an imperative. Okay? So imagine that the principle has a narrative, or maybe the absence of one, but it could be considered a narrative. And this narrative is going to induce posterior beliefs with some distribution theory 1. And basically, the posterior meaning has to be equal to the prior meaning, E bar. So you can think about a convincing positive narrative as someone who basically changes your decision towards a equals one. So that's the case where the prior meaning of the agent is lower than E star, which is the cutoff remember for the behavior, and E is greater than E star. Or conversely, you could have a negative, a convincing negative narrative. But the game is this one. The principal can choose between disclosing the narrative and issuing an imperative. So you can also say, I can also tell you, you should be able more, whatever this means. Or I can give you a story for which, you know, which you can use to, then you can decide for yourself. Okay? An effective imperative is one that induces a probability. So we consider two cases, one in which there is a privacy interpretation, and the other one in which there is a need for flexibility. Maybe I could just move on to the second one. Actually, there are some interesting things with the first one as well, but I realize yes, I'm a bit on the other side, right? So let me just say, even for flexibility. So imagine that narrative allows you to understand things better, and then you can have some complementary information that basically tells you what the narrative applies or not. So basically that signals something about you help build the decision. And then UP is a function of sigma, if you take this growth, the narrative E, and then there is refinement at the H of any way of sigma. And then you ask yourself whether an imperative can exist. Now, the condition for existence of an imperative, so think about R is a set of E of narratives so that the narrative is not disclosed, and instead the principle is imperative, is that the expectation of E is relatively conditional on the imperative being issued. But for the optimality side, it must also be the case that those in I want to choose to go through the imperative route. Okay? And that means that when you go through the imperative route, you are going to impose good behavior even when E is less than E star. And I should say, even less when sigma is less than E star, I should say. Even when sigma is less than E star, where sigma is the posterior belief mean that there is an anxiety. Okay. So, what we studied, and I'm realizing I'm going way too fast to explain well, but it's fairly intuitive, basically, the principle of the choice between an imperative or giving a narrative. What's going to happen is that if you have enough congruence between the principle and the agent, then you can go through the imperative route. You must have enough congruence. And that's exactly what you think. You know, if someone tells you to do this, you must trust a person. It's just like in Crawford, so you must trust a person to do it. But then there's a cost. And the cost is, of course, that if it turns out that in that particular circumstance, the anxiety is not that big, the person is still going to, the agent is still going to do it. And when you look at self-control, then you have two effects. So when self-control goes down, that means that there's a more of a discrepancy between the two tests, and then obedience becomes more problematic. But then also the empathy becomes more attractive. So as long as you can get away with it, so I realize I'm going to be. So in this model, which is very consequential, is very utilitarian, you may actually get imperatives. You may actually get this kind of behavior. Okay? So just let me conclude here, and maybe we can talk a little bit more about this later on. So what I did was to develop a model, which is based on my area, it's called Enabu, in which morality is individual and is also socially determined, and it's impacted by incentive, of course, and it accounts for many realities. Again, it accounts for, we have to be careful, those are also experiments which do not test directly the framework, so it's very encouraging. And one of the things we want to do is to run experiments which are more geared toward testing. Morality is animal. We have lots of examples like this. We know that organizational structure are going to be very important in determining the morality. Narratives are going to affect, and one of the striking things in the example I gave you is even pretty weak narratives are going to be very powerful. And people know pretty well not to give back narratives when it's self-serving. Imperatives can arise and are very specific conditions under which imperatives can arise. It's completely uncluttered territory in economics. We need more theory, we need more experiments. But I hope, with this very brief account, that you'll find the topic interesting, and I want to thank you for your attention.